Hello, everyone. Welcome to the FCCJ. My name is Tim Horniak. I'm a freelance journalist here. 13 years ago, Masatoshi Koshiba of the University of Tokyo appeared here at the FCCJ after winning the Nobel Prize in Physics for showing that subatomic particles known as neutrinos coming from distant exploding stars could be detected on Earth. Today, I have the honor to welcome to the club another University of Tokyo physicist, Takaaki Kajita, recipient of the 2015 Nobel Prize in Physics. Dr. Kajita will be honored next month in Stockholm, along with Arthur B. MacDonald of Queen's University in Canada, for showing that neutrinos undergo oscillations, which indicates that they have mass. So, billions of neutrinos are now streaming through our bodies, and yet these neutrinos are so light that they're able to stream through more than 1,000 light years of lead before interacting with it even once. According to an article I was reading, I asked Dr. Kajita about that earlier, and he said, maybe. Anyway, I think it's a testament to the ingenuity of mankind that scientists were able to build instruments sensitive enough to measure such elusive particles. So Dr. Kajita is here to tell us more about these mysterious neutrinos and what they can reveal about the nature of the universe. Before we begin, please turn off your smartphones and other devices or set them to silent mode. And with that, I will ask Dr. Kajita, and I will first say congratulations again for winning the Nobel Prize this year. And I will ask you if you could please start things off by perhaps telling us how did it feel when you were first contacted and told that you won the Nobel Prize?
Okay, thank you very much. Well, okay, then your first question about the how I felt when I received the phone call. Yeah, well, I was really surprised. That was kind of almost unbelievable. So maybe that's all.
Almost unbelievable. That seems to be quite an understatement. I think I would jump out of my skin if that happened to me. But so do you think that the high of winning is still going strong for you, or do you think things have calmed down a little bit? You feel a little bit more relaxed after that thrill?
Well, okay. Compared with that moment, I'm a little bit relaxed now, of course.
Okay. You've given several press conferences already in Japan for Japanese media, but I believe this is the first time you're going to give a press conference about the subject in English. And thank you very much for that. Now, neutrinos is something that perhaps we may have heard of, but not everyone is familiar with. I certainly would like to know more about neutrinos, especially since billions of them are flowing through us right now, apparently. Could you tell us, basically, what is a neutrino, and why were you interested in studying it?
Oh, okay, well, the first question, what is neutrinos? Well, okay, that is a difficult question. We are studying neutrinos, and I would like to know, what are neutrinos? Well, anyway, the very short answer to the question is, well, neutrinos are one of the elementary particles, and maybe you can imagine you remove the electric charge from an electron. Also, you remove almost all of the mass of an electron, then it's almost a neutrino.
Huh, okay. Interesting. I think a lot of us are probably familiar with the electrons because they're part of atoms that we know a little bit about. And if I'm correct in my understanding, electrons and neutrinos are kind of like cousins.
Yeah,
they're both leptons, right? What is a lepton? Well, that's probably something even more complex. But so neutrinos seem to be similar to electrons, but as you said, they have no charge, no electrical charge, and no almost no mass.
Okay. Right.
So why did you want to study neutrinos?
Okay, actually, when I started my research, I was interested in proton decay. And, well, therefore, I joined Kamio Kande experiment. Kamio Kande experiment was initially designed for the search for proton decays. However, in every experiment, there are backgrounds. And the most serious background for proton decay searches are neutrinos. So from the beginning of the Kamio Kande experiment, we have been observing neutrinos as backgrounds.
Interesting. Before I ask you about proton decay, something we should also learn about, what is the Kamio Kande experiment and where does it take place?
Okay, well, Kamio Kande is a big detector. It contains, Kamio Kande was. We have no more Kamio Kande, but anyway, the Kamio Kande was a big water detector. It contained 3,000 tons of water, pure water, and we watched the neutrino interactions or proton decay in the water using the famous large photomultiplier tubes. And it was located in a zinc mine in Kamioka, Gifu Prefecture.
Okay, interesting. So essentially this very large vat of water with these photomultiplier detectors was located in the mine. Quite a depth.
Yeah. Well, it is about 1 kilometer deep if we measure from the top of the mountain.
Okay. So below, so 1 kilometer below the summit of the mountain.
Yeah, right. Right.
Why is it important to have the detectors so deep in the mountain?
Well, okay, what we wanted to observe was so rare, so we would like to minimize the background as much as possible. Well, I said that neutrinos are background, but before neutrinos, we have another background, that is the cosmic rays. And if we locate the detector at the surface, then the cosmic ray background rate is so high, therefore it's extremely difficult to carry out the experiment. So we went underground.
I see. So you avoided a lot of that background noise by placing it underground, okay. So I think a lot of us may have seen photos of the Kamio Kande experiment, the large pool of water with the detectors around it. And so could you tell us what happened and when you were first able, or your team was first able to detect neutrinos there?
Well, first detection of neutrinos was just a few days after the turn on the experiment.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, was it a shocking moment, or did you expect to?
The first kind of shocking moment at least for me, was the October, November of 1986. And at that moment, I have been studying the new, analysis tool. And I have developed the new analysis tool, and I confirmed that tool works properly for simulation events. We say Monte Carlo simulation, but anyway, for simulation events, okay. The program worked fine. Then, just as a check, I started to apply this program to the real data, real atmospheric neutrino data, and I found that the number of muon neutrinos are much less than expected.
I see. So you mentioned muon neutrinos, and perhaps you could also explain the different flavors of neutrinos, which is key to your winning of the prize.
Yes. Well, okay, usually we simply say neutrinos. However, we know that there are three types of neutrinos: electron neutrinos, muon neutrinos, and tau neutrinos. And in my studies, I have been always observing muon neutrinos and electron neutrinos.
Okay. And so, what happened? You were looking at how neutrinos can change, I believe, from one type to another. This was a key part of the prize, I mentioned. How were you able to show that neutrinos can accomplish this change?
Okay, well, first of all, the answer was mu neutrinos change type to tau neutrinos. However, well, in the Kamiokande and super Kamiokande experiments, the detection of tau neutrinos are extremely difficult. So therefore, in the initial studies, what we observed was the, say, disappearance of muon neutrinos only.
Okay.
And the key measurement was the disappearance of muon neutrinos as a function of flight lengths.
I see.
Yeah. Well, when neutrinos travels only for short distances of, say, 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers, they do not change their type. However, if they travel for more than 1,000 kilometers, that is the diameter of the Earth, then they change their type.
Oh, that's interesting. What causes the neutrino to change its type?
Oh, that is the most difficult part to explain.
Okay. Please.
Okay, what causes the neutrino oscillations? Okay, well, if I start to really explain the mechanism, maybe it would take 30 minutes, then you do not understand. So I just want to mention that, well, if neutrinos change their type, that implies that neutrinos have masses.
Yes, that's okay. A key point. Yeah. And yeah, that's what the Nobel Committee mentioned, of course, that by showing that the neutrinos can change from one form or flip from one form to another, they must have mass.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Would it be easy to explain why must they have mass if they flip?
Yes, okay. Well, this is the explanation I sometimes use. Well, maybe you heard about the special relativity of Einstein.
Yes.
And according to him, if anything, matter, moves fast, then the clock on that matter, it moves rather slowly compared with the clock, which is standing here.
Right.
And if the matter moves faster and faster, then clock is more and more difficult to move.
So time will slow down.
Right. And if the matter moves, this particular matter moves with the speed of light, then there's no time change. Always say 5 o'clock is 5 o'clock, no time. And if there's no time, then you cannot change anything because, well, change from A to B needs time.
Right.
Okay, now we look at neutrinos. They change their type. That means they need time to change their type.
I see. Okay.
Okay, though, so then if neutrinos travel with the speed of light, then it's clear that they cannot change type.
Oh, I see. Oh, okay.
So they travel with the speed that is less than the speed of the light, and this is common to any particles that has mass. if neutrinos have no mass, then they have to travel with the speed of light.
Right. Wow. Well, that's a very concise explanation. I'm sure it's very detailed when you get into the calculations, but fascinating. Well, speaking of neutrinos having mass, if I understand correctly, the standard model of particle physics, which you may have heard of, which is a set of equations, perhaps, or principles that describe very well the observed experimental results in particle physics. According to the standard model, neutrinos should not have mass. But now you have shown that they do have mass.
Yeah.
And this is a big problem. What what has been the reaction of some of your colleagues when they were looking at your results?
Well, okay. If I recall the early days of late 80s, the initial reaction of our colleagues were rather skeptical.
Yes.
Yeah. Therefore, it took us essentially 10 hours to convince the world community that neutrinos change their type.
10 hours or 10 years?
So, 10 years, sorry.
That would be too easy for 10 hours.
Yeah.
But I've also written or read some articles suggesting that, you know, this is, of course, a major problem for the standard model, and it represents a crack in the standard model. What do we have to do now to overcome these cracks?
Well, okay, this is actually a very good suggestion that, well, towards the deeper understanding of the elementary particles. For example, in the standard model of particle physics, well, we know that there are, say, three forces, strong forces, weak forces, and electromagnetic forces, but they are essentially independent. However, in a more, say, advanced or deeper theory, people proposes that these three forces should be unified. And we think that the observed small masses of neutrinos could be a key to the physics of this, say, deeper level understanding.
I see. Are you talking about the grand unified theory?
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Right.
So this could be a step toward the grand unified theory,
yes.
which is quite amazing. Okay, very interesting so far. Before we open it up to questions, I had another question. I recently visited the Kamioka mine out in the mountains. Basically, it's at the border of Toyama and Gifu prefectures. To visit not the Kamiokande or Super Kamiokande experiments, but a new kind of experiment called Kagra, which is basically a very long laser detector to try to detect gravitational waves. Dr. Kajita is also involved in this experiment. Could you talk to us about what is a gravitational wave and why is it important to try to detect that?
Okay, well, the gravitational waves are predicted again by Einstein, general relativity, and this is kind of, wave generated by the motion of heavy masses, and, well, first of all, we are interested in gravitational waves as a physicist because the observation of gravitational waves tell us that our space-time is not really a static thing, but it's kind of dynamic thing. Also, if we are able to begin the gravitational waves, then it will open up a new astronomy called gravitational wave astronomy. And by that new astronomy, we expect that we can, say, observe the formation of black holes or merger of black holes, well, these are unable to observe by, say, other means, such as, say, optical telescopes. So we are really going to start a completely new astronomy. That is our excitement.
Absolutely fascinating. Sounds like science fiction. Okay, maybe we can open it up to questions now. I'm sure there are a few questions. Usually we have the members of the working press have first dibs at questions. Any questions from journalists here? Please put up your hand. And yes, please. And please state your name and affiliation, et cetera, and try to keep questions to one question. Thanks.
Erich Bonner, freelance journalist from Germany. I was wondering, when were you actually sure that you had discovered that a neutrino has mass? Was it something that you discovered being by yourself or in a conversation with the other prize winner?
Well, the moment I personally convinced that neutrinos changed their type was the summer of 1997, when we finished the first round of the super Kamiokande data analysis. And at that moment, our data clearly showed that the neutrinos coming from above are not changing, the neutrinos coming from above are coming as expected. However, neutrinos coming from the other side of the Earth are much decreased, almost by a factor of two. That was the moment I personally convinced that neutrinos oscillate.
You mean the number of neutrinos coming back was about half?
Yeah, right.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions, please? Yes.
My name is Takaaki Kajita. Independent, write for Yuka Fuji, mostly program news, but I'm a science writer as well. Mm-hmm. And I usually write about the radiation and radiology, so I'm totally nervous about the neutrino. But it seems that the neutrino has a weight. Mm-hmm. Means that it's not just a invisible, unknown existence, a matter. Mm-hmm. So it's a totally new paradigm, is my understanding. And it seems that another new world appears just in front of us because of the experiment and your finding and the theory was proven. So what kind of effect this is a question, what kind of effect does it have to the academic society or the industry or our way of living in a short term or long term?
Okay, for the short term, well, there must be no effect to our life, to our technology. Well, for a longer term of maybe 1,000 years, well, I don't know, I'm sorry. I have no idea what will happen after 1,000 years. But anyway, well, in short, the observed small neutrino masses may not have direct impact to our life.
No impact.
Oh.
we talked about this just earlier, but just by the way, when we say neutrinos have mass, could you help us to understand how light they are? I know it's very hard to explain if you don't have display,
okay.
But
yeah, yes. Okay, well, you know electrons.
Yes.
And electrons are lightest elementary particle, And if compared the masses of heaviest neutrinos and the lightest elementary particle electron, then the heaviest neutrino mass is approximately 10 million times lighter than the electrons. So neutrinos are really, really, really.
Can say that again, yeah. And just another question. When you are observing the interaction of a neutrino with the water particles, right? What is happening when the neutrino strikes something? What do you see and what is going on?
Okay, good question. Well, okay. Of course, most of the neutrinos just pass through our detector. However, really some of them interact with, say, with the oxygen nucleus or hydrogen. And then, suppose muon neutrinos hit the oxygen nucleus, then muons appear.
Wow, okay. And you can detect the
and we can detect these muons.
I see.
And actually, in that way, we call that we observed neutrinos.
I see. Okay. How often would this happen? For example, if you had the detector running for 1 month, how many interactions would you see in a month?
Okay. Well, our detector, called Super Kamiokande, has the total mass of 50 kilotons. But, well, for the physics, we can use only 22.5 kilotons. Within this volume, we observe about 10 neutrino events per day.
Oh, I see. Okay. So fairly routine.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And when you say most of the neutrinos just pass through the water without any interaction, what is making some neutrinos interact? Is it just a random chance?
Yeah, just a really random chance.
Okay. Okay, interesting. Any other questions, please? Yes, please.
Khalil Hassan, I'm Ambassador of Bahrain. Originally, I am a surgeon, a medical doctor. Why I'm saying this? Because it's very confusing. You know, you're talking about very, very, very tiny things. Now, we are discovering smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller particles. And I don't know where we are going to end. My question is, now, quantum theory depends on the speed of light. That the light, correct me please, because I'm not a physicist. You know, the highest speed in nature is the light. Am I right or wrong?
Maybe I misunderstood. But
could you say the question again?
Yani, what I understand, the quantum theory depends on very important principle that the light is highest speed.
Yes, yes.
Wave. Now, is this going to be same what we think today, or this will change after 10 years, 20 years? Are we going to discover something else that might change our thinking about quantum theory as a whole? Thank you.
Okay. Well, I think the quantum mechanics is really a basics of our present day physics, and I don't think it's likely that we find any new, say, principle. Quantum principle is really the really for us is really the fundamental thing.
Okay, good answer. And of course we can never break the speed of light, right? was it last year or the year before there was that experiment in Europe that claimed to have shown that some particles were traveling faster than light?
Yeah, that was also a neutrino experiment.
So neutrinos are always surprising.
Yeah, but it turned out to be wrong.
Yes, yes, of course. Because if it were correct, that would be a major crack in what we know about the universe. Any other questions, please? Yes.
John Boyd, freelance. Maybe more than a question, these are clarifications. I don't understand why the neutrinos coming from the other side of the Earth should be less than those from above. And also, you mentioned that knowing neutrinos have mass is going to impact what?
The standard model.
The standard model and cosmology, our way of understanding cosmology. Could you go into that a little bit more, please? I didn't really understand
why
it would impact.
Well, first of all, about the neutrinos coming from above and the other side of the Earth. Well, naively, the number of neutrinos coming from above and coming from the other side of the Earth should be essentially identical. Mm. That is our naive expectation. However, well, now we know that neutrinos change their type when they travel long enough distances.
Did we know that before?
We didn't know, no. That was our discovery, yeah.
Okay, thanks.
And then about the consequence of the small neutrino mass to say cosmology. Well, actually, this small neutrino mass has an extremely important implication to the cosmology. Well, we do not know yet, but maybe the small neutrino masses could be the key to the understanding of the baryon asymmetry of the universe. That means Our universe, well, we are made of matter. There are no antimatter in our universe. However, if we think about the history of the universe, when the universe started as Big Bang, then essentially the equal number of matter and antimatter should have been existed. However, when it cooled down, somehow only matters remained. And we physicists would like to understand why. And we believe that neutrinos could be really the key to this understanding. Neutrinos with small masses could be the key to this understanding.
Because
they're
associated with antimatter, or?
Well, that is a little bit complicated story. Well, maybe I could try to explain a little bit. Well, neutrinos are really light. Their masses are very, very tiny. And we think that there must be some special reason for that. And, well, theorists predict that in association with this small neutrino masses, there must be some extremely heavy neutrino-like particles. We do not know them. They are too heavy, so we are unable to see them. But these particles should have been existed during the Big Bang. And these partners, heavy partners, are unstable and decay. And during this decay, some source of matter was generated. That was the theoretical prediction. And we physicists would like to check this theory as much as possible.
Very interesting. Is that okay, John?
Yeah, but again, why neutrinos from the other side of the Earth are fewer than those coming from above? I don't understand.
Okay, because neutrinos change their type, and muon neutrinos changed to, well, about half of the muon neutrinos changed to tau neutrinos, and we cannot observe tau neutrinos. Therefore, the observed muon neutrinos was only half of the expectations.
So they were there, but you couldn't see them?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. I have a question regarding cosmology and the origin of the universe. You mentioned that, or many people have mentioned dark matter. You didn't mention it here, but many other researchers looking at dark matter. Could neutrinos have any role in the search for the nature of dark matter in the universe?
Well, okay. Actually, well, of course, since neutrinos have masses, neutrino total weight of the neutrinos in the universe is not zero. That is correct.
Right.
However, neutrinos' masses are too small. Therefore, they cannot be the major part of the dark matter.
I see. And what is dark matter for those who are not familiar with dark matter?
Well, unfortunately, we do not know. we are actively searching for these dark matter particles, but we do not know yet.
Why are scientists interested in this concept of dark matter? What is the puzzle?
Well, first of all, dark matters are, again, particles that most probably the particles that are not within the framework of the standard model. So that it could be the another breakthrough to the deep understanding of our particles and the universe.
Okay. Yeah, as far as I understand, when scientists look at the way the cosmos is moving around, there's not enough matter to account for the observed movement. So they predict this dark matter, but we don't really know what dark matter is,
right.
As you said. Okay, any other questions, please? It's a very complex stuff, I know, but yeah, sure, please.
Does the rate of change for the neutrinos depend on the distance traveled? Or in other words, would more have changed if they had been allowed to travel further and come back?
Okay, very good question. In fact, the rate of change depends on the travel length. However, the way is like this. Well, for a while they do not change, then they change to other types. Then they come back to the original type. Then they change to the other type again. So just oscillating. Therefore, people say neutrino oscillations.
So you have to catch them at the right phase to see the change?
Well, in principle, yeah, we are catching this kind of wavy pattern, yes.
I think I read that many of the changes occur in the sun, when neutrinos are coming from the sun. I read that the changes happen within the sun instead of within the space between the sun and the Earth. Is that,
yeah, I think that's that correct? Is correct for solar neutrinos.
Okay.
Yeah. And in fact, when I say the neutrino types change as a something like a wave, that is for atmospheric neutrinos.
Okay.
And the story is a little bit complicated for solar neutrinos.
So could you refresh our understanding or improve our understanding of the different kinds of neutrinos? There are solar neutrinos. Mm-hmm. They come right out of the sun.
Mm-hmm.
The sun generates them,
yeah,
in the reactions happening within the sun. And then atmospheric neutrinos, which are the product of cosmic ray
interactions in the atmosphere.
Okay, and they produce atmospheric neutrinos. Besides those two, we have more, right?
Yes. Well, if I concentrate on the neutrino oscillation experiment, there are two other ways. One is to use the neutrinos produced by nuclear power reactors. They produce lots of anti-electron neutrinos.
Ah, so are you talking about nuclear power plants?
Nuclear power plants, yes.
I see, yeah. Wow. So are you saying that if we go to a TEPCO facility that's actually running, we can measure neutrinos?
Yes.
That's very interesting. What about coming from things like other objects in the cosmos?
Well, actually, good question. Well, neutrino physicists would like to observe neutrinos coming from other astrophysical objects. However, well, in the history, we have only one, and recently another one. The previous one was the neutrino observation in 1987 for the supernova neutrinos, and supernova neutrinos, and another one is the recent experiment that is carried out in South Pole. They started to observe the neutrinos produced somewhere in the universe.
They don't know where?
We don't know yet.
Oh. So more mystery surrounding neutrinos. That's amazing. Okay, any other questions? Yes, please.
I'm Rick Weisbird. I'm a scientist running a scientific editing and translation service. So physics seems to be among the most internationally collaborative activities in the realm of science. And I'm just curious how, I guess you must teach a lot of young Japanese physicists, and how is their appetite for international collaboration compared to physicists who come from other countries to Japan or travel for?
Could you?
Okay, so the equipment for physics experiments is huge and very expensive,
yeah, right,
and often
right.
involves international collaboration.
Yes.
So I'm curious, could you compare the appetite for international collaboration by Japanese, young Japanese grad students and physicists compared to those from other countries?
I see. Okay, well, good question. I think, in general, Japanese students are more quiet compared with the U.S. students. Well, compared with the Korean students, I think they are almost the same. That's what I observed.
Mm-hmm. But do they have a lot of passion for this kind of physics?
Well, that is common. They are all very...
Do they really want to find some amazing discovery, like your team did?
Well, as far as people involved in Super Kamiokan, yes, they are very much eager to find something new.
Okay. Do you think it helped you to have Super Kamiokan, which is kind of a kind of sexy experiment, because it's kind of cool, it's in a mine, it's huge, there's lots of water, detectors, it's neat. did this help maybe with relations with the government or other agencies that fund you?
Well, unfortunately, even if it's sexy, it cannot be related to the funding.
Yeah.
Well, we have to produce good results. That is the way we get the funding.
Okay. What about after the news of the Nobel Prize? How will this change your research, your work?
Well, actually, we don't know yet. However, in October, end of October, I met the Prime Minister, and he mentioned that the basic research is important. That was really a good time for me.
Do you have more students in your classes if you are teaching at University of Tokyo? Are you getting much more attention from students now?
For that, actually, I don't know yet.
I see. It's too early.
Yeah, right.
Any other questions, please? Maybe over here.
Thomas Sullivan, Dr. Kajita, I'm an associate member here. Congratulations, first of all, on your tremendous honor. Much of this I'm having a lot of difficulty understanding, but I wanted to ask you a general question. What do you think are the two or three biggest scientific priorities in the world at the moment? Would you be able to?
Well, that is a too big question to me. Well, if you could concentrate on underground particle physics experiments, I could mention two, three big topics. Okay? Okay, well, first of all, one of the reasons we constructed super Kamiokande was to observe proton decays. That is really important towards the deep understanding of the elementary particles. So this is really important. And also, as I mentioned earlier, we do not know what are dark matters, and there are a lot of activities to detect these dark matter particles, so that is also important. And also, as I mentioned, the small neutrino masses have a profound impact to the understanding of the cosmology. Therefore, we need to move on with these neutrino studies. They are the three big issues that we have to really understand.
Okay. Other questions, please? Just go over here. Yes, please.
My name is Sakishima, associate member. I would like to ask you about the Japanese universities, in particular national universities. I understand the Japanese government has been reducing annual budget to national universities in the last 10 or 15 years, 1.2% a year or something like that. If this situation continues, could we still expect that the Japanese scientists will be awarded the Nobel Prize in the 20 years or 30 years later? Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much for this question. Well, of course, we do not know what will happen, but my expectation is if this continues, not only the Nobel Prize, but also the whole Japanese scientific community should be extremely damaged. I think even now we have been damaged very seriously.
Okay. Thank you. Back to John.
Again, another clarification. You mentioned at the South Pole, the neutrinos, we don't know where they come from. Why are they different from other neutrinos? That's the clarification.
Okay, yes.
And
yes.
Could you go more in depth into your studies or research of gravitational waves? Mm-hmm. What kind of equipment are you using? Anything like that, please?
Okay, thank you very much. And for the first question, in the South Pole, there are huge experiment, huge detector called Ice Cube, which has essentially 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer size, and they recently start to observe extremely high energy neutrinos that cannot be explained by atmospheric neutrinos. And therefore, we conclude that these neutrinos must be somewhere from the universe.
So there are different types of neutrino, not just the shape changing with the wave.
Okay, the types. Types are electron neutrinos and muon neutrinos. So as far as the type is concerned, they are same.
Maybe the origin is
origin
is
different.
The mystery here.
Yeah.
Right.
The origin is different.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And your
gravitational wave. Yeah.
Yeah.
Gravitational wave. Okay.
Yes.
our gravitational wave detector is called Kagra, which is a 3 kilometer by 3 kilometer arm length laser interferometer. And this is located again in the mine in Kamioka. Well, not the active mine, but in the same mountain as the Super Kamioka and the experiment. And well, the arm length is slightly shorter compared with the US LIGO interferometer, but same as the European Virgo interferometer. And well, our detector uses a special technology, that is, we are going to use the cryogenic mirrors to reduce the thermal noise, which is a fundamental noise to against the detection of the gravitational wave. So with this cryogenic technology, we'd like to reduce one of the important noises for the detection of the gravitational wave.
I have a question. Do you think this cryogenic technology will give Kagra a better chance of actually detecting gravitational waves?
Well, okay.
Compared to other detectors?
Well, okay, we do not know. Well, not only the detector characteristics, there is another axis, that is the timeline.
Timeline?
Yeah, our project started a little bit later. So other projects are more in advanced stage. So we do not know, so for example, who will be the first to detect gravitational wave.
Right.
But well, after some time, we are going to collaborate in order to really start the gravitational wave astronomy. We really have to collaborate with all these interferometers.
And again, for those who have trouble understanding gravitational waves, like me, some of us have seen, you know, videos of science videos, for example, of a large bowling ball put down on a rubber sheet, and the bowling ball bends the rubber sheet. This is an example or an illustration of how space-time can become deformed, right,
yeah,
by a large mass.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So the gravitational waves would be something similar to the bowling ball on the rubber sheet.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, gravitational waves are produced when this ball is moving at that position.
Okay. And both the space and the time are being distorted. It's hard for us to imagine, but time and space can stretch a bit.
Yeah, yeah. But well, for simplicity, maybe you could simply imagine that space is distorted.
And for Kagra, the laser interferometer, you have to measure a very, very tiny difference in the laser when it travels 3 kilometers.
Yeah.
How big is that difference that you have to measure?
Okay, well, I'd like to mention with the example, with the actual numbers. Suppose a gravitational wave come to our solar system. And now we know that the distance between the sun and the earth is 150 million kilometers. Then this space is, disturbed by this gravitational wave. And it may shrink, it may get longer, and this length change is less than, I would say, about 10% of the diameter of the hydrogen atom.
Wow. And this is something measured for 150 million kilometers. The difference would be 10% of the diameter of a hydrogen atom.
Yeah.
So an extremely, extremely fine measurement.
And unfortunate thing is, our interferometer arm length is much smaller than the distance between the sun and the earth.
Yeah, naturally, yes.
So we have to be much more sensitive than the 10% of the hydrogen atom.
Incredible. Any final questions before we, yes, please. Sure, yeah.
I'm Hiroshi.
Okay, sure.
I'm Hiroshi Yoshida, associate member of FCCJ. And the my question is, if you could be able to choose the place in the world, you may get the detectors facility for a neutrino. Where did you choose? Or Japan is the best place to do?
Well, okay, good question. Actually, for some neutrino experiments, our depth is actually not enough. For some neutrino experiments, such as solar neutrino experiment with heavy water, we really need about 2 kilometer depth. Therefore, Japan is not the right place to locate these detectors. And therefore, in fact, they selected Canada.
Great, well. Okay, we have a question down here at the left.
My name is Byron Siegel. I work for a pharmaceutical company. I have a very different question. Now that you're a Nobel laureate, you now have a platform to take your career in a totally different direction, it seems to me. I've heard Professor Yamanaka speak in his work with stem cell research, and he's done a lot of work changing policies and in trying to shape healthcare. And I'm wondering, since you've become a Nobel laureate, have you given thought about what you want to do now that you couldn't have done before?
Good question.
Good question. Well, I'm afraid that I didn't have time to think about this kind of things. Sorry.
Any other questions, please? Yes, sure.
To be honest, I'm very confused.
You're not the only one.
No. You know, time for us, we look at the watch and say time. What is time for physicists?
Good question.
Okay, yeah, well, in some cases, from the, say, start of the experiment to the end, it could be 10 years, 20 years, and maybe 30 years. In case of Super Kamiokande, we started the construction in 1991, and we are still operating the detector. Well, in fact, from now on, we are going to modify the detector in order to start a new study with this detector. So this is our time scale.
Okay. Any other questions? Yeah, sure. Let's have one final question, please. Yeah.
It seems that cosmic rays and solar activity has a huge impact on the neutrinos. Does a change in activity on the surface of the sun have any impact on your experiments or on the neutrinos that are around us all the time at all?
Well, the activity of the solar surface, does not affect to the Super Kamiokande experiment on as far as the neutrino part is concerned. However, actually, we would like to observe neutrinos produced by the activation of the solar surface. And, well, unfortunately for this study, Super Kamiokande is a little bit too small.
So you're going to have to build an even bigger detector
somewhere
in the mountains, perhaps deeper, too.
But, well, of course, in order to study the surface effect of the sun by neutrinos, we need a huge detector, but maybe this is not the most efficient way to study the solar surface mechanism. Therefore, we may use the money to other ways to study these effects.
Do you know of scientists who study other scientists that study that?
Yes. There are a lot of activities that study these solar surface effects.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we're going to wrap it up now. I'd like to thank you very much, Dr. Kajita, for coming here and explaining everything so patiently. We really appreciate it. And again, congratulations for your Nobel Prize. It's a wonderful achievement. And on behalf of the FCCJ, I'd like to give you an honorary membership here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming.